In this video, you will learn about the types of DSC, principles of DSC, DSC curves and their applications, factors affecting DSC results, and in the last section, I will explain about a specialized DSC technique that is used to study in-depth transitions that happen within polymers. Let's start with what DSC is and see why this is so important. Differential scanning calorimetry is a thermal analysis technique used to study the thermal behavior of materials. It involves measuring the differences in heat flow between the sample and the reference material as they are taken through controlled temperature changes. DSC curves provide information about the thermal behavior, which are used in processing, design, and in end-use applications. There are two main types of DSC. Heat flux DSC is a type of DSC in which the heat flow into or out of the material is directly measured as a function of temperature. This is in contrast to power compensated DSC, where the temperature difference between the sample and the reference is kept constant by adjusting the power supplied to the sample. The heat flux DSC consists of a single furnace block in which both the sample and the reference are heated and cooled together. The furnace block is designed to supply heating at a linear rate. But not only should the heating rate be kept linear, but also the cooling rate, which is maintained by a separate cooling accessory. The sample and the reference pan are placed on a constantin disk. Constantin is mainly used due to its low changes in resistivity at different temperatures. The temperature sensors are disc-shaped chromal constantin area thermocouples and chromal aluminum thermocouples that are placed just below the disk. At the start, the sample and the pans are in equilibrium. As the block is heated, the sample and the reference also start to get heated. Both these will lag behind the block temperature to a different extent, since the heat capacity of the sample is more due to the higher mass. Note, specific heat capacity is the heat absorbed by a unit weight of the sample as it moves through 1 degree C increase in temperature, which is why more heat is required to raise the temperature of a heavier sample. The temperature of the sample, block, and the reference are measured by the thermocouples. Heat flow is calculated based on the thermal equivalent of Ohm's law, as shown in this equation, where Q dot is the heat flow, delta T is the difference in temperature between the sample and the reference, and R is the thermal resistance of the heat leak disk. Unlike the heat flux DSC, the power compensated DSC consists of two holders, one for the reference as well as the sample, each having its own sensors and heater. These two calorimeters are placed in a common block having a certain temperature. Platinum resistance thermometers measure the temperature. Next to the thermometers, two individual heaters are also built right below it to control the temperature. Once again, as the furnace is heated, the sample calorimeter lags behind the reference calorimeter due to its mass. The sensors capture this temperature difference and sends an increased power onto the sample heater to minimize this temperature difference. The instrument records the power difference needed to maintain the sample and the reference to the same temperature as a function of programmed temperatures. Power compensated DSC is less sensitive compared to heat flux DSC, but it has faster response times, which is why it is used for kinetic studies in polymers. The DSC curve consists of the heat flow in the y-axis versus temperature in the x-axis. The graphs that are plotted are particular to the instrument that you use. In our case, the positive side of the y-axis corresponds to exothermic reactions, whereas the negative side of the y-axis corresponds to endothermic reactions. Glass transition temperature is the temperature at which an amorphous polymer changes from brittle, hard material to a soft, leathery material due to the changes in chain mobility. The glass transition temperature, which is also called the TG, does not happen at any one temperature, but over a range of temperatures. This is seen as a step in the DSC curve. There are three ways to label the TG. The first is using the inflection point or the point of the maximum slope. The second type of determination for the TG is using the half height method, where two horizontals are drawn and the midpoint is taken, intersecting with the curve to get the TG point. And the last method is the half width method, where two verticals are dropped as shown in the graph here, and the midpoint is taken as a TG. So why is the glass transition temperature so important? Analysis of the glass transition temperature gives you an idea of the operating temperature for the polymer. A temperature below the TG can make the polymer susceptible to failure. The next important point is melting. Melting is an endothermic process where heat is absorbed by the polymer to break its chain. Note that melting is seen in crystalline polymers only, not in 100% amorphous polymers. Melting takes place in a range of temperatures within the DSC curve, but the average temperature of the sample remains constant. The main characteristics of the melting curve is the onset of melting and the peak melting temperature. Knowing the melting point can help you identify the type of polymer as well as to check if there are multiple different polymers present in your sample. The next useful information that we can get from polymers is the percentage crystallinity. Most crystalline polymers are not entirely crystalline. They have amorphous regions where there is no order in their structure. Crystallinity is important because it affects other properties like the storage modulus, density, and melting point. This is obtained by calculating the normalized heat of fusion and comparing this with the 100% crystalline sample of the same polymer. A 100% crystalline polymer is hard to come by, and hence we will have to resort to published data. Now let's look at enthalpic recovery. The presence of enthalpy relaxation is a sign that physical aging has occurred. Physical aging is a very important phenomena that happen in amorphous polymers that are kept below its TG for extended periods of time. This can cause polymers to fail. It is a relaxation process that occurs below TG, and the magnitude of the relaxation peak is a sign of the extent of its aging. This is a densification process where the volume decreases and it can lead to embrittlement. Enthalpy relaxations can also lead to dimensional changes and development of stresses. For unknown samples, the presence and the size of the enthalpy relaxation peak can give information about the thermal history of the material. At a certain temperature above the glass transition temperatures, the polymer chains begin to form an orderly pattern, leading to an exothermic reaction releasing energy. This is called the cold crystallization. This can be seen in the heating part of the DSC trace. Now let's look at the factors affecting the DSC results. Number one reason is choosing the right pan. Choosing a pan with a good thermal conductance is very crucial when running the DSC testing. The most common pan that is used for polymer studies is aluminium. Other pans like copper, platinum can also be used based on your budget and the sample that is being analyzed. These pans are to be properly crimped such that there is good thermal contact between the sample itself and the pan. Poor thermal contact can cause incorrect readings in your DSC results, and the presence of air gaps can influence or lead to incorrect analysis. The next important point is the sample mass. A very high sample mass can lead to undesirable thermal gradient within the sample itself. The linear proportionality between the sample mass and the heat rate can be lost. On the other hand, too small of a sample size can lead to loss in sensitivity. The typical mass to be used for DSC testing is between 3 to 15 milligrams, although the mass can extend up to 20 to 40 milligrams for heat capacity studies. Do consult with your machine supplier before running the testing. The rate at which the sample is heated can affect your testing results. A high heating rate can mask some kinetic effects or create kinetic artifacts, whereas too slow of a heating rate can prolong thermal events. In this example, we see a PET sample heated at different rates. The melting points for lower heating rates shift to a higher value. A high purity purge gas that does not contain moisture is to be used within the heating furnace block. Historically, nitrogen is used due to its availability and cost. Helium is also being used more recently due to its higher thermal conductivity. Due to this, it can produce faster response times. It can also cool down your system faster, thus reducing your downtime. The main drawback, however, is the loss in sensitivity due to its absorption of the heat from the sample. Now let's jump to the most interesting section, where a specialized DSC technique shall be discussed. This is called the modulated DSC technique. The main drawback of the conventional DSC is that it cannot resolve overlapping transitions, which is where modulated DSC comes into the picture, where it can clearly resolve what's called the reversing and the non-reversing processes, which we shall discuss shortly. Another advantage of MDSC is that it has increased sensitivity compared to conventional DSC. In MDSC, a different heating profile is applied to the sample and reference. Specifically, a sinusoidal modulation is overlaid on the conventional linear heating or cooling ramp to yield the profile in which the average sample temperature continuously changes with time, but not in a linear fashion. There are three main parameters which are used to control the MDSC experiment. The first is the average heating rate, which is kept between 1 to 10 degrees C per minute. A temperature modulation period between 30 to 100 seconds is maintained. And the last parameter is the temperature amplitude, which is generally around 0.1 to 2 degrees C. The MDSC works on the governing equation as shown here. Here the heat flow can be divided into two components. One component that depends on the heat capacity and the rate of temperature change. And the second component is directly proportional to the temperature itself. This contains all the kinetic transitions. Thus, when we introduce the linear ramp, we get information on the temperature changes, whereas a sinusoidal temperature profile gives information about the specific heat that is more to do with the rate of temperature changes. The kinetic component or the temperature dependent component is called the non-reversing heat flow, and the specific heat component or the rate of temperature dependence component is also called the reversing heat flow. All three signals are shown in this plot of a PET sample. Now let's look at the first reversing signal. As we heat the sample, we see the glass transition temperature at around 75 degrees. As you continue to heat, cold transition takes place and a small decrease in CP can be seen. As we further heat the sample, the melting process begins to take place. Now let's look at the non-reversing signal. As we begin to heat the sample, we can see a small blip in the curve, which is the enthalpic recovery that we discussed in the previous sections. In the conventional DSC, the glass transition and the enthalpic recovery both overlapped, and we could not resolve these two components separately. As we continue to heat the sample, cold crystallization of the amorphous PET material is seen. And this curve continues to have an exothermic reaction, as can be seen through the crystal perfection, which happens right near the melting point. And that takes us to the end of the video. I hope you got a lot of pointers that can help you analyze your next DSC curve. Subscribe for more videos related to material testing. DSC, you in the next video.